Ever wonder what lies beneath? Below our cities, it's like a secret world most of us never see. Running through a maze of pipes are rivers, buried against their natural will. And now, they want out. This is Dartmouth, Nova Scotia, nicknamed the City of Lakes, a place where people are naturally drawn to the water.
I think it's something deeply rooted in us, right? You know, it seems to be where we want to go, we want to congregate.
At the water's edge.
At the water's edge, yeah.
And Sam Austin is a former urban planner turned city councillor for the area.
Water is not meant to be put into a pipe buried underground. That's such an artificial way to deal with it, right? It's meant to be above ground. That's where it's meant to be in the environment.
But that's exactly what this city did, bury the Sawmill River, a once vital waterway named for the sawmill that provided lumber to build Halifax in the 1700s. Long before that, a source of food and a transportation route for the Mi'kmaq people. So why bury it in the early 1970s? Well, at the time, it seemed the best response to a catastrophic flood. ...1971's Hurricane Beth was the stuff of Dartmouth legend. Austin wasn't even born back then, but he knows the stories.
The Hawthorne Street gave way, and the dam that was here, it overtopped, and the water just poured right through downtown Dartmouth, did a pile of damage, flooded a bunch of homes, took the bowling pins right out of the bowling alley, and they floated off down the street.
The engineers thought, best try to manage the storm water in the future, stuff the river in a pipe, contain it, and sure, go ahead, build over it. And that's what they did.
The idea in the 1970s was very much, you know, man versus nature. We can control this, we'll put it into pipes, we'll put it into channels. You know, kind of we look at it now as, well, that was a bit of a mistake.
The pipe did do its job, but it also stopped fish from traveling upstream. And now, old, rusty, and due for replacement, it's also too small to handle a major modern-day storm.
All the development in the drainage basin, climate change, all the projections were the pipe is not going to handle a repeat Hurricane Beth event. So it was actually a have-to project, right? Because the alternative of doing nothing was going to be the bowling pins floating down Portland Street again.
Portland Street is part of bustling downtown Dartmouth. The Sawmill River runs right underneath it.
This is the best vantage to see where we'll have natural pond.
So how do you control the water and solve the underlying pipe problem? One solution, release the river. It's called daylighting. That would mean tearing up this intersection to let the river flow.
But this is a bit of a conundrum, isn't it?
It is. This is hard to do, right? Because you've got an elevation change. You've got this six-story government building right here on the side that's right up against the property line. You've got limited space. You need a road to go through, and you need to get the water through. And ideally, we want to have a walking trail along it.
So there's tall order.
Yeah, they're working on a feasibility study right now.
Well, even though they hadn't solved the riddle of the intersection that's halfway down the river, the city was so confident daylighting was the right solution, they decided to start at the top anyway and work their way down. They finished the first phase last spring, daylighting about 300 meters of the Sawmill River. It was left to engineers at the utility to make it happen. James Campbell is spokesperson for Halifax Water.
When the project's underway, you have to pump the water that's flowing around the actual construction zone so the construction workers can actually do their work. It's not as easy as just putting a pipe in the ground. It's far more challenging. It's much more of an engineering feat. It takes a little longer.
The price tag for the first phase was $9 million. $6 million of it came from Ottawa. But there was a catch. Department of Fisheries mandated that any solution here must provide passage for fish, including one species known as the Gaspereau.
This is the fish ladder, so the fish don't like a consistent flow, they like variation. And then the other piece is they like light, so bringing the water up and creating this sort of environment for them, hopefully it'll be, the Gaspereau will run through here again.
To free this section of the trapped river took roughly 5 months. And now, short of a couple of places where it couldn't be avoided, the river babbles along. From this pond, down the new fish ladder, under a street by a gas station, around some businesses. Even in this place, under this parking lot where the river isn't let out, grates let the light in. And it flows to here, halfway to Halifax Harbour.
So what we're looking at here is going to be the transition point between the old and the new. So as you can see, it's pretty cool.
That square part, that's the new, bigger, brighter passage.
The lifespan for this, what's left, isn't very long, is it?
And then there's the old pipe waiting to be removed.
So the old system, or the system you see behind us, could handle roughly 18,000 liters per minute. Up here, it's about 30,000, so significantly more, so quite a bit more capacity to handle stormwater.
A significant improvement once they figure out how to get around that intersection and those buildings just beyond. Sounds daunting, but the entire daylighting project is forecast to be more cost-effective than replacing the pipe and building a separate fish ladder.
I just feel joy and pride in it.
Right? To Austin, it's meant to be.
Very few times that you have things really line up the way they did for this. You had the pipe needs to be replaced, we need to do stormwater, we've got federal money. Everything just kind of lined up just perfectly.
And there's no question in his mind, the whole of the Sawmill River, banished underground for so long, will see daylight. Tom Murphy, CBC News, Dartmouth, Nova Scotia.
What a fascinating project. And just so you know, Dartmouth isn't the only community with rivers buried below the surface. And some of those cities have also turned to daylighting as a solution. Just look at Seoul. The Cheonggyecheon stream was once covered by an expressway. It was restored in 2005 and now serves as both flood relief and a major tourist destination. And in Zurich, Switzerland, daylighting is actually the law. Urban river restoration has been going on for the past 30 years.